friends, welcome back to my channel. So today in this video lecture, we are going to study about anatomical structures related to mandibular dentures. Okay, anatomical landmarks for maxillary denture has already been covered. You can click on the I button above and see that video. Okay, so let's begin with the mandibular denture anatomical landmarks first. So we'll begin with the primary support areas first. Okay, here the area which is marked with blue color is your buccal shelf area, okay, which creates a primary support for our mandibular denture. Great care must be taken when making the impression to cover the available area in this region. The buccal shelf area can range from 4 to 6 mm in width in normal mandible, but in resorbed ridges it could be as less as that of 2 to 3 mm. And in mandibles where the buccal shelf area is less and the ridges are resorbed, it is very difficult for the denture retention. Another key feature about buccal shelf area is this upward slope in this area. Okay, if you'll see like this, this upward slope in the buccal shelf area, it resists the mandibular denture for moving distally. Now the posterior alveolar ridge can be considered as primary support area if the ridges are not that much resorbed, okay, but in most of the cases they are greatly resorbed, and so we consider this area as a relief area. So the major support for your mandibular denture will come from buccal shelf area. Ridges will not play a huge role for the primary support of mandibular dentures. Now the anterior alveolar ridges. The anterior alveolar ridge, which is bounded distally by the extraction site of canines on both the side, they tend to resorb under load and is considered as a secondary area of support. But in most cases, it is considered as a relief area, okay, when we see it clinically. But if the ridges are good and not that much resorbed, then it can act as a secondary support area. Now here is our lingual frenum, okay. So lingual frenum is a fibrous band of tissue that overlies the center of the genioglossus muscle, okay. Which muscle is present in this area is genioglossus muscle. It is usually a narrow single band, but in few patients, or you know, rarely, it can be two in number. So careful clearance of lingual frenum is very much important, because the lingual frenum is attached to the tongue and inadequate clearance may result in pain or displacement of the denture. On the other hand, lingual border seal is very critical to the retention of the denture, and over clearance may result in loss of seal and loss of denture as well. Now the important thing about frenums in general which we should keep in mind is frenums, they consist mainly of fibrous connective tissue, okay. They do not contract or expand like muscles. They are accessory limiting structures for the tongue, lips and muscles of the cheek, okay. So whenever the accessory frenums are present, if at all, then it is always advisable to not to reduce but to relieve such frenums. Because once you will give a adequate relief to any frenum which is accessorily present, it will resolve your issue. There is no need of surgically removing the accessory frenums, and it might cause surgical scarring in later stages. Now the labial frenum, okay. It is usually a single narrow band, but it may consist of two or more bands. And the activity of this area tends to be vertical, okay. So the labial notch in the denture should be narrow but not wide, okay. The notch should be narrow. And the mandibular labial frenum is usually shorter and often wider than the maxillary labial frenum. Now the buccal frenum, as you can see here, okay, it is usually found in the first premolar region, and it is usually a single frenum, but it can be two or three in number. The oral activities in this area are horizontal as well as vertical, okay. So wider clearance is usually needed in this area. The contour of the denture will be a little narrow in this area due to the activity of the depressor anguli oris muscle. Do keep in mind which muscle acts in here? Depressor anguli oris muscle. Now the labial vestibule is the area which is from one side of the buccal frenum to the other side of the buccal frenum. Basically from premolar to premolar, this is your labial vestibule. And the main muscle which acts in labial vestibule is your orbicularis oris muscle. Activity of this muscle is usually in horizontal direction. So we should be very much careful not to overextend the impression in this area, okay? If we do overextend the impression in this area, then it might unseat the denture again and again, and our denture will be poor retentive. The another muscle which acts in this area, we are talking about labial vestibule, is the mentalis muscle, okay? So mentalis muscle originates from the mental tubercle and it inserts in the lower lip, which is orbicularis oris fibers are already there in the lower lip, okay? So it is vertical muscle and it may be active in some patients. To accommodate this activity of orbicularis oris and mentalis muscle, careful border molding is required. Another thing which you should keep in mind is when the ridge is fair to good, okay, the labial border should be thin. It shouldn't be very much thicker, it should be thinner of 1 to 2 mm since a thicker border will distort the lips. When the ridge is flat, a thicker border is needed for lip and cheek support and to provide a better seal. Now the buccal vestibule, okay, this area starts from our buccal frenum, distal to buccal frenum till our retromolar pad, okay. This is your buccal vestibule on both the sides. So the buccal vestibule width and length are mainly dependent upon the buccal shelf area and the buccinator muscle which acts in this area. Adequate support requires that the buccal flange extend to the outer edge of the buccal shelf. You can see the green marking over here, okay? So ideally your denture border should be till here. It should cover the buccal shelf area completely, and then here should be your denture border where the green boundary or the outline has been drawn, okay? Or else it should be below your external oblique ridge for adequate support. The length of the buccal flange is not critical for peripheral seal because the drape of the cheek provide a facial seal. The entire buccal shelf may not be covered in situations where the buccinator muscle is hyperactive. Again, the origin, insertion and everything about the buccinator muscle is very, very important for us. Okay, we should know it in great detail. So I'm gonna upload a separate video on muscles of mastication, okay, so that you guys can get a detailed idea about muscles of mastication, its origin, insertion and its action. It should be very clear in our mind as we are dentists. So the buccal shelf area can be completely covered in most situations, and this border should be about 2 mm thick and always smooth and round, okay? Otherwise it will impinge your cheek. So when the ridge is flat, it is usually desirable to make the border thicker to provide better cheek support and better seal. Otherwise, it has to be 2 millimeters thick. Now, the area which is influenced by masseter muscle is distal to your pear-shaped pad, okay, over here. This area is influenced by your masseter muscle, distal to pear-shaped pad. So this large and powerful elevator lies over the buccinator muscle, and its action usually creates a straight line from the base of the pad to the distobuccal area of the denture. This area must be border molded correctly because overextension causes soreness in this area. The masseter muscle is an elevator and it closes the jaw so that the denture cannot displace. Underextension may result in a loss of support and resistance to distal displacement. So a proper recording of this area is very much essential while you are doing border molding. Now the myelohyoid ridge, okay, it provides the origin of myelohyoid muscle. Now note the distal end of the ridge is closer to the crest. Okay, it might not been drawn very clearly, but the distal end of the myelohyoid ridge is closer to the crest. And the anterior aspect is closer to the lower border. It is important to determine the prominence and sharpness of the myelohyoid ridge. A prominent ridge can seriously interfere with the development of a correct lingual flange, and a sharp ridge may cause pain, especially during mastication. Another anatomically important ligament which attaches on the distal end of your myelohyoid ridge is your pterygomandibular raphe. It originates from the pterygoid hamulus of the medial pterygoid lamina, and it attaches on the distal end of your myelohyoid ridge. Submandibular fossa is a concave area in the mandible below your myelohyoid ridge. Okay, this is your submandibular fossa. It is a bony landmark and has little significance in impression making. Now the lingual vestibule. Okay, the only way to achieve great retention in your mandibular denture is by properly recording your lingual vestibule, okay, or your alveolingual sulcus. It is basically divided into three parts. You might be seeing this black demarcation, okay. So the anterior vestibule, okay, this anterior first region, it is called the sublingual crescent area or anterior sublingual fold. This middle area, okay, this middle area is called the myelohyoid area, and the distolingual vestibule, the last portion, is called the lateral throat form or retromyelohyoid fossa. Now this anterior lingual sulcus which you see, okay, it is influenced by genioglossus muscle, the lingual frenum, and somewhat by the posterior portion of the sublingual glands as well. The action of these muscles are mainly to raise and protrude the tongue. The genioglossus muscles are attached to the genial tubercles. Okay, as you can see here, these are genial tubercles. So genioglossus muscle is attached over here. Genial tubercles, you see here, okay, they are very small protuberances of bone near the midline of the lower border of the mandible. Okay, now the middle or the myelohyoid vestibule, okay, here it is influenced by myelohyoid muscle and somewhat influenced by the sublingual glands as well. The myelohyoid muscle is the largest muscle in the floor of the mouth, and its principal function occurs during swallowing. So its intraoral appearance is misleading because the membranous attachment makes the muscle appear to be horizontal when contracting. The length and width of the myelohyoid flange is determined by the membranous attachment of the tongue to the myelohyoid ridge and the width of the hyoglossus muscle. And it can only be determined by skillful border molding and impression procedures. There is usually a great deal of variation in the amount of displaceability and the difference between the visible and the actual vestibular space. Okay, so it is always advisable to do the digital palpation in this area, okay, and then choose the correct impression technique to record this area. Now the distolingual sulcus, okay, the distolingual sulcus is referred to as the lateral throat form or retromyelohyoid fossa. This anatomical area is probably the least understood and is frequently misunderstood. The lateral throat form is bounded interiorly by the myelohyoid muscle, okay, and laterally by the pear-shaped pad, and posterolaterally by the superior constrictor muscle, and posteromedially by the palatoglossus muscle. I would also try to attach one image which can show this area very properly with all the muscle attachments. Okay, So it is the so-called S curve of the mandibular denture, as viewed from the lingual, it resolved from the stronger intrinsic and extrinsic tongue muscles, which usually place the retromyelohyoid borders more laterally and toward the retromyelohyoid fossa. They oppose the weaker superior constrictor muscle. The posterior limit of the mandibular denture is determined mainly by the palatoglossus muscle and somewhat by weaker superior constrictor muscle. So this area is called the retromyelohyoid curtain. Okay, retromyelohyoid curtain. The classification of lateral throat form as given by Neil is very much important, okay? So do keep in mind and note it down. Most of the edentulous mouth have class 1 and 2 lateral throat forms. Class 3 is very much rare. Now the sublingual glands, they are located above your myelohyoid ridge, okay? Below the myelohyoid ridge is your submandibular fossa and submandibular gland, and above your myelohyoid ridge is sublingual gland. As we all know, here in this area, tongue is present, okay? Sometimes large tongue can be annoying during the impression procedures, and but it is usually helpful for maintaining your border seal. Lingual tori are bony protuberances which are ordinarily somewhere located in the premolar region, somewhere here. So the tori rarely increases in size, but the mucosal covering tend to be very thin, and any settling will cause pain and discomfort. It is almost impossible to develop a peripheral seal when a torus or tori are present. If surgical correction is not possible due to physical or psychological reasons, the patient must be informed that a compromised result is to be expected. So the lastly, the retromolar pad area, okay, Craddock has given this term pear-shaped pad for retromolar pad, okay. Two different books and different authors have described this area with different names. But this area, if we say it as retromolar pad area, then it has a very crucial role in obtaining peripheral seal for your mandibular denture and for support as well. Now we'll quickly see which are the primary stress bearing area, relief areas, okay, and the limiting structures. Whatever you are seeing with green as your periphery, okay, it creates your peripheral seal from buccal as well as lingual. The relief areas, all the red marked areas which you see are your relief areas, okay. So all the frenums, okay, all the four frenums which we are gonna relieve, as well as the myelohyoid ridge, okay, and the crest of the ridge of the mandible, okay. But if the ridge is very good, if you find a good ridge, then you can obviously use it as a secondary stress bearing area, but in most cases it will go for a relief area. Then your labial vestibule, which I have marked it as a yellow color, okay, so it can also act as a secondary stress bearing area. And lastly, the pear-shaped pad, it is very much difficult to classify that whether it is a stress bearing area or what does it do actually. It depends upon the anatomy of this area, okay, which varies from patient to patient. So what we have to remember for retromolar pad is it is important to obtain support and peripheral seal, okay. So we have to cover it completely till here to obtain the proper peripheral seal and support. This was all about it. Thanks for watching. See you in the next video.